Hi everyone, my name is Emil, and I'll tell you one very interesting story that has taught me a lot. I live in a small town with just over 1,000 people living here. Everybody knows each other, and if they don't, then they have at least heard of one another. Our town is known for its cheese and fine wine, which we sell to big cities nearby and even sometimes abroad. Almost every family here knows how to make wine. Of course, this all inspired me to want to go into winemaking. My parents and two brothers own a small shop that sells souvenirs to tourists. We also sell our own cheese and wine. Once, an old-looking man came to us. He was wearing a designer suit and a large hat, and an actual parrot sat on his shoulder. This was wild to see, especially in our small town. The parrot was bright in color, had a large beak and beautiful long feathers. I stared at the bird in amazement, unable to take my eyes off it. The owner of the bird, seeing my interest, said, "You like my parrot? His name is Leo, a rare breed of Inca cockatoo." I said yes, I would, and I asked if I could pet it, but the owner backed up a little, saying that Leo takes his time to get to know a person before he can trust him. And if he's scared, he could fly away. Therefore, it's better I shouldn't touch him. Then the guest began to inspect our store products. He bought a lot of gifts and suddenly stopped at the shelf with wine. With enthusiasm, I told him about the variety, the different types, and how we make it. The man looked at me and said with a sad tone,
"Do you know who you remind me of? Me, 40 years ago, had the same look on my eye. I dreamed of growing my business, but my parents did not support me, and even worse, forbade me to pursue my dream. I wanted to breed birds, namely parrots. And you know what? I obeyed them, and didn't study where I wanted, and didn't work where I had dreamed. And only recently have I given up on everything to make my dream come true. And I'm happy. I now have a small farm where I breed parrots."
I smiled at my new acquaintance. He suddenly took the cockatoo from his shoulder and put it on my hand.
I was astounded. "You seem like a good kid. I'd like to give you my beloved Leo so you can remember to chase your dreams. Look after him. He's a rare species and very expensive. Treat him with respect."
I was so happy but at the same time confused. I'd never received such a gift before and I didn't know how to react.
"Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir."
The man chuckled and waved goodbye. And I looked at my new pet and could not believe that a complete stranger just gave it to me. Leo, surprisingly, behaved calmly and didn't try to fly away. Several weeks passed and Leo became an official member of our family. Everyone loved him and always fed him tasty treats. And he loved to chirp and gently perch in our hands. Once in the store, when my mom was working at the counter, I was putting up new products when I suddenly heard a sound, as if something had fallen. I ran up and saw that my mom was lying on the floor unconscious. I was really scared. I started screaming, called the ambulance and tried to wake my mother up. The ambulance got there in a few minutes, but it felt like an eternity. The doctors quickly put my mother on a stretcher. My dad came in and told me to stay in the store, and he would go to the hospital. For the rest of the day, I was worried sick about what happened, and I prayed that it was nothing serious. In the evening, Dad got all of us and sadly said that Mom had a serious illness and that we needed a lot of money for her treatment. When Dad told us how much, we realized that we had to either sell the store or take out a mortgage on the house. I couldn't sleep all night. I felt horrible. I didn't know what to do. My mom's life depended on a few stacks of paper. How unfair! I paced from corner to corner, laid down, got up, and paced some more. I looked at Leo in reassurance and suddenly it hit me. That old man said that the parrot was very rare and very expensive. I quickly went online and started to research how much an Inca cockatoo costs. Seeing the price, I immediately ran to tell my dad about it and that we didn't have to sell the business anymore. Dad was delighted and hugged me, but he also asked that wouldn't I have to part with my favorite pet? I honestly said that it would be hard, but my mom's health was way more important. And plus, I was sure that Leo would end up in a loving family. I posted a picture of him online with a price and submitted it on an exotic pet selling website. And the very next day, a buyer called me and wanted to see him in person. An hour later, an expensive car was parked outside the house, from which a respectable man got out. He walked into our house and carefully examined Leo. Then, without bargaining, he held out a suitcase with the money and put him in the cage. Leo looked at me with sad eyes. And it was so hard for me to say goodbye to him, but we had no choice. We transferred the proceeds of the sale to my mom's operation, and with our fingers crossed, we sat waiting for the results. The operation lasted several hours, and when the doctor came out, he said that everything went well. We just jumped with joy. Our mom will live on. Several months had passed. Mom was much better. She was fully recovered from the operation. Our life had become finally the same as it was before. And sometimes I look out the window and remember my first and most beloved pet, Leo. Recently on the internet, I saw a photo of the man who bought Leo for me. Turns out, he was a famous nature documentarist. He loved animals and kept them in a huge park where they preserved endangered species. The man held Leo and gave interviews, saying that this beloved pet is his pride. These words made me feel really happy inside. Leo is in good hands. While reading the interview, I didn't notice how my mom entered the room. She quietly hugged me by the shoulders and thanked me that I saved her, and as a token of gratitude, she wanted to get me a new pet. Of course, we couldn't afford an Inca cockatoo, but I can choose any animal I like. I hugged my mom and in thought, thanked the man who saved my mom's life by buying Leo. The next day, my parents bought me a little cute cockatoo, and I named him after my first parrot, Leo. And now I no longer want to be a winemaker. I wanted to start raising and training parrots to sell them to good children and adults, because there are a few things better than looking after a beautiful living creature. If you liked the video, then please leave a like and subscribe to our channel.
Hello everyone, I'm Kathy, and this year I graduated from college. I was always a good student and graduated with honors. I even got a huge scholarship for my academic excellence. You might think I'm a nerd, but people who study come in all shapes and sizes. Way back, my dad owned a pastry shop. At first, he bought buns and cakes and delivered them to the shops, adding his own pastries for his clients. Then he got more and more clients and had to hire an assistant. Then his small business began to grow, and dad bought a space where he could manufacture our products to scale. I remember the times when my dad came home happy and told us about how another store or supermarket had agreed to supply his candy. So many years passed, and our business has gained more popularity. One of my dad's friends, Uncle Stefan, offered to franchise dad's business, and he said he wanted to be a partner. Dad liked this idea, and soon we opened a second branch downtown. Our shop was famous for the cool design and insanely delicious pastries. Uncle Stefan spent almost every day at our house. Him and my dad discussed new projects, menus, talked about the wholesale purchases. Since I was a kid, I treated him like my own uncle. And guess what? It's that very same trust that he got us cheated. A year had passed since the opening of the shop. By that time, I had just finished college and was looking for a job. My dad said I should temporarily work at his pastry shop until I found a new job. I gladly agreed. That job would allow me to improve my accounting skills, and my boss would be Uncle Stefan, which is perfect since I know he would help me. When I started, I immediately got to work with financial statements. Several hours passed, and I was shocked to realize that the reports that were given to my dad versus the ones that were sorted on the computer are very different. While I was checking the numbers, Uncle Stefan came in and was clearly not happy with me working there. He asked me what I was doing and why I was sitting at the accountant's chair. I told him I will now manage all the expenses and income myself, and that I'd even agree to work for free. Instead of being happy with this, Uncle Stefan's face looked anxious. It was clear he did not like this. After a while, I realized why. Uncle Stefan was stealing from Dad. He lowered the official store income, and he took the differences for himself. I didn't expect such betrayal from such a close friend of Dad's. Angry, I immediately went to my dad, where I told him about what Uncle Stefan was doing. Dad heard all this and was furious. At first, he did not really believe me, saying that maybe I had not been accurate or missed something. But when he saw the reports, Dad was distraught, unable to digest what such a close friend had done. My father called Uncle Stefan on the phone and they had a terrible fight. Uncle Stefan refused to admit what he did and even insulted my accounting, telling Dad that I'm an inexperienced fool and it's because of me that I'm making an honest man look like a crook. Dad told me to go to the office immediately and get the computer so that no one could change or delete anything. I immediately drove to the office space, terribly worried and feeling that this business could end so easily. Arriving at the second branch, I was going up to where the accounting computer was and had almost reached it when I heard voices coming from my office. Uncle Stefan spoke to someone in a half whisper, and in the corner, I noticed the old accountant. Delete everything, just erase it. Let's just say we can't find the reports. Better yet, we could write new ones. Do it, what am I paying you for? Make new ones so that the donkey thinks it's his daughter's fault. I realized in horror that they wanted to set me up. Quickly, pulling out my phone, I started recording what they were saying. We need to get out of this business. Let's put something in the pastries or whatever. Let's make him lose clients, his reputation, close his shops, and right at this time, we'll open our own pastry shops. We need to act first thing tomorrow morning. I quietly left the corridor, and with horror, realized what a cunning plan Uncle Stefan had prepared. But I had the recordings, and I can give them to the police. But damn it, there isn't enough evidence. These are just conversations and they could just dismiss it. I need to act differently, to catch them, red-handed. I went home, deciding not to tell anyone anything, and gave myself one day to come up with a solution. All night, I thought about what to do, and finally came up with a plan. If they really want to ruin the product, fine, let them. Having made my way to work, as usual, I entered the shop, hiding behind the cabinets. I set up a small camera on top of the shelves and waited. Time passed, and the pastry chefs were the first to come. They changed, began wiping the tables, and began to spread the dough. At this time, a former accountant came in and handed them a bag of powder, saying that this is a new taste brought from India and that management had approved it. The pastry chef shrugged his shoulders, added the powder to the flour, and continued the business. While the satisfied accountant happily went to report everything to Uncle Stefan, I immediately went to the cooks and told them to bake only 2 buns and put the remaining dough aside. While the buns were ripe in the oven, I called the police. The evidence was all there, and now the time for reckoning had come. As soon as the police arrived to the building, I escorted them to the boss's office. The accountant was there too. Seeing us at the door, they made a surprised expression and asked the police what the issue was. Mr. Stefan Miller, allegedly, you have committed embezzlement, tax fraud, and had intent of sabotage and endangering the public by adding your poison flour to this establishment's products. Is this true? Uncle Stefan grinned and said through laughter, do you really believe this little liar or a reputable businessman? This is baloney. The girl just wants to take my place and run this business with her father. This angered me more. I have recordings, photo and video evidence of how your accountant asked to add poison to the product. Mr. Stefan laughed and said that the tape was probably faked and the video edited and the powder was just a food supplement. Okay, since everything is fake, then please try the buns with your food supplement. The men looked at each other. Mr. Stefan said that he does not eat starchy foods and that the accountant is allergic to sweets. The policeman, realizing that something was wrong, quietly pushed the plate towards the men and gestured to try. Mr. Stefan and his accomplice reluctantly took the buns and, barely taking a bite, grabbed their bellies, turned blue, then green, and squealed in pain. It then became obvious. The police grabbed and arrested them, taking the uneaten buns as evidence. I told my father about what I did, and after a couple of hours, we had all the evidence needed for them to go to jail. Now, Uncle Stefan, or Mr. Miller, as I like to call him now, faces a serious time. Now, Dad trusted me with the second branch and is very happy with my management, because now he's got someone in the company he really trusts. If you liked the video, then please leave a like and remember to subscribe.